The soldiers tried to clear the narrow streets, but the crowd pressed in to see the man condemned to die on Calvary. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, all the way to Calvary. He was bleeding from a beating. There were stripes upon his back, and he wore a crown of thorns upon his head. The scorn of those who cried out for his death. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like a lamb came my Messiah, Christ the King. But he chose to walk that road out of his love for the souls of a man, made its way through the heart of Jerusalem. Down the Via Dolorosa, called the way of suffering, like a lamb came my Messiah, Christ the King. And he chose
talking through this or this. Happy, happy, happy Sabbath. It's good to be here. It's good to be here among old friends, new friends. And I'm always very thankful for the gift that God has given us in His Son, Jesus Christ. Because our theme is forever friends. And the older I get, I'm coming to appreciate the value of true friends, real friends, friends that kind of stick with you through thick and thin. And Laura and her family fall into that category. And there's several of you out there also that have a special place in my heart. And so I'm thankful. I count it a privilege. But it's because we share a common love. And that's the love of Jesus Christ. That's our relationship with Jesus Christ. And because we have that love in him, through him, sometimes we don't see each other for years, but we know that we love each other. And one day soon, we will be forever friends together with Jesus. Now, I tease her a bit because I remember her when she was, she was bigger than that, but it just seems that way. To hear her singing now and to be able to sing along with her is a privilege and a joy. But when I met her, she was fun. She's always been full of life. When we would go over to visit with her, Laura would always get me and she'd say, "Let's do something." Or sometimes she'd call me up on the phone and she'd say, "Let's do something." And so I'd have to think of something to do. Or she would think of something, very creative young lady. And finally, we're doing something together. We worked on an album together called Forever Friends, and this is our first concert that we've done together. And so thank you for sharing that with us. And again, it only serves to draw us closer to each other and appreciate each other and appreciate Jesus and what he has done in our lives and what he continues to do in our lives and what he promises to do in the future. Some of you know my story, but I'm going to back up because there may be a few of you in here that don't, and I'm just going to tell you a little bit about myself. In 1959, and you're going to know how old I am, but in 1959, I was about 5 years old, and I was fascinated with the television. I was drawn. I used to look at the tube, and I'd wave and wonder, why don't they wave back? But anyway, my mother would come along, because I'd always be like right up in front of the TV, and she would grab me by the feet, and she'd pull me back, and she'd say, "You're sitting too close to the television. Pull me back." On this particular evening, I was watching a program called The Ed Sullivan Show, for older folks like me who know The Ed Sullivan Show. And there was this charismatic black man on there, and I loved the way he moved and the way he sang. And I remember he said, "Deo, deo, daylight come and me want go home. Come, Miss Dolly man, dolly me banana. Daylight come and me want go home." And I said, "Mama, mama, that's what I want to do. I want to be just like him," because I knew that back then, for a black man to be doing what he was doing on national television, even though I was a little squirt, I knew that that was a great accomplishment, and I guess in the eyes of the world. And so I said, "I want to be just like him." Now, you had to know my mom. She was a 5'8" Jamaican woman with hands almost as big as mine. And when she said, "Oh, no, you won't," you obeyed, because you didn't want to experience the wrath of mom. Those were loving hands, but they also knew how to administer discipline. And she said, "You will go straight to hell if you do that." So to avoid the wrath of mom and of God, because that scared me as a young boy, I put it behind me, but the seed had been sown. And I always tell parents, it's really important that we make sure that we don't send our children mixed signals. I had a wonderful mother, and she did the best that she could raising two boys in New York City on her knees. Sometimes I say alone, but she didn't do it alone. And so, but it's important because we all make mistakes. And I say it's important that we don't send our children mixed signals, because even though she told me it was a dangerous thing to be involved in the entertainment industry, she bought Harry Belafonte's records into the house. And she used to love every time when she had moments, she would listen, she'd watch when she could, when she had time. And she thought it was so cute when she'd see her son running around with a little microphone singing his songs. So in my mind, I'm thinking, how bad can it be? Fast forward, college. God gave me an opportunity. We can't put God in a box because he knew the end from the beginning. He knew where I'd be today. And so I believe the Lord allowed me to go and seek some of those things. I don't believe that was plan A, but I trust, as I look back, that God never left because he was hearing the prayers of my mother. But he allowed me to dabble into the entertainment industry. And I thought, New York City, this is where I grew up and this is where I wanted to be, the big city, the lights, the city that never sleeps, I'm gonna do it my way, all of that stuff. But I want to praise God, because after several years, between his Holy Spirit and God uses people, he sent an angel, an old friend, a woman that we used to sing in school, in church together. We used to sing in the church choir together. I was 15 and she was 19 years old, and I looked up to her and admired her as a big sister because, one, she had a wonderful voice, and two, she had a relationship with Christ, and I admired it back then. And God sent her along the way. You don't just run into people in New York City. I ran into her three times. The first time, we were out in the world together. And I was sad because I remember what it was like when we were walking with the Lord. So it was hard to see her out there in the world. Second time I ran into her, 59th Street in Columbus Circle. For anybody that's ever been to Manhattan, you know it's a busy street, very busy place. Third time, maybe I was coming from an audition or something, and she invited me to a Bible study. I went to that Bible study that night because she had several celebrities attending her Bible study. She invited me to the Bible study. She told me I had wandered far away from God, but now I'm on my way home, and I want you to come. And at first she said, come on Friday nights. And I said, no, I'm not ready yet. But then she mentioned some of the celebrities that were coming to her Bible study that night. Because you see, she had become very well known in the music industry, and she was doing very well. And when I heard those names, I thought, wait a minute, I like to sing. I think I'll go to the Bible study and further my career and meet the celebrities. I'm doing fine on camera, but I want to make it on the other side of the music industry. So I went to that Bible study that night with the intention of meeting the celebrities. And you know, people say we need new music today to keep our young people in the church. That's a lie. I went to that Bible study and it was a joy. When I went up in high-rise Manhattan, she was living on the east side, I was living on the west side of Manhattan, and I went into her apartment, went up the elevator, and as the door opened, I could hear this beautiful music, music I hadn't sung in many years, and talented. It's a joy when you can be with people that sing and know how to sing. And I heard the music coming out of the door, and I knew which way to go. I had never been to her apartment before, but I knew which direction to go in. And so I went, knocked on the door, and they were singing songs, gospel songs that I hadn't sung in many years. And I couldn't wait to join them. And we sang song after song for a good 45 minutes to an hour, but it wasn't the music that touched my heart that night. We opened the Word of God, and we studied the Bible until 2 a.m, and I couldn't get enough. Something happened to me that night. I went to the Bible study to meet the celebrities, and I met the celebrity, and he changed my life. People have asked me over the years, do you miss what you used to do? And I can honestly say, Even though I used to love what I did, there is a completeness, there is a joy. I know to whom I belong now. I know my purpose in this world. And it has nothing to do with what I was pursuing back in those days. The song I'm going to share with you is called Give Me Jesus. Because that's all I want today. That's what I want. Because when you have Jesus, you have everything.
Give me Jesus.
So I told you about Mom, and speaking of forever friends, Mom became. Yeah, I couldn't stand Mom when I was growing up because Mom was always correcting me and telling me what I should and shouldn't do. She used to come into our bedroom in the mornings, and I thank God now as I look back. You know, as children, we don't fully understand. There's so much that we don't understand, and I believe that's why God gives us a lifetime to grow often, I guess, you know. And she would come into our bedroom in the morning and she sang hymns. She had so many hymns in her head. And she would sing at the top of her voice. So you'd be in a dead sleep. And all of a sudden, boom, you know, there's Mom singing one of those hymns. And you'd pull the covers over your head because you were annoyed. At least I was, my brother and I. And Mom would sit at the foot of our bed. She'd pick my bed one morning, the next morning my brother's bed, because we slept in the same room. And she'd give you, you could stay under the covers for the first verse. But you better be out by the second verse, and you better be up singing. And now, I just treasure those hymns. I lost Mom, 2016 of April. She had become such a friend. But we have the blessed hope. That's another friend that I can look forward to having forever. It's my prayer that by God's grace, I will be ready when Jesus comes, because I want to see Mom, and I want to spend forever with her and with Jesus Christ. This is one of the songs that she used to sing. And I've put my little flavor to it, but it's one of the hymns. O Thou in Whose Presence.
Re-echoes the praise of the Lord.
You'll say something.
You know, so often when we look back and we read the story of the children of Israel, and we see how God led them over and over and over, and he worked amazing miracles for them. And yet, every time the next challenge and the next trial would come along, they would start complaining again, and they would start murmuring. And it's so easy when we read that to think, man, what is wrong with these people? Don't they ever learn? And yet, so often we can find ourselves doing the same thing, can't we? God will work in our lives over and over. And yet when we face that next challenge, we start getting stressed and we start getting anxious and doubting again. When all we need to look back, all we need to do is look back and see what God has done for us and trust Him. And so I want to share with you a little bit from my own personal experience, because we're told that when God does things in our lives, we should share them, right? And so I'm going to try and share with you as much as I can, but this story gets harder and harder to tell the more I tell it, because it keeps expanding. But I'll do my best, and I'll start at the beginning. How many of you have heard of Fountain View Academy? Okay. There's a few. Well, for those of you who don't know, Fountain View Academy is a boarding school up in British Columbia, and it's known for its choir and orchestra. And we would travel around all over the place and shoot music videos, make DVDs out of them, and do concerts. And I attended there for 4 years and graduated in 2011. And every year we have what was called the Cali Tour, which is 2.5 week long Christmas tour all up and down the West Coast. And my junior year, I was given 2 solos in this concert, and I was so excited. I could not wait to get started. And I practiced, I knew the songs, I was feeling good about it. And so the first night rolls around, and I'm sitting on the front row. And about 10 minutes before the concert, all of a sudden, for no reason at all, my voice just completely disappeared. It was just gone. I couldn't talk, I couldn't sing, nothing. And to say that I panicked was an understatement. And I started running around trying to find a backup, and there wasn't one. And there was nothing I can do. Next thing I know, I'm standing on the stage, and the orchestra's playing. And I was so nervous. And thankfully, I had the presence of mind, and I started to pray that God would give me my voice back. And as soon as I opened my mouth to sing, all of a sudden my voice came back. Everything was fine. And so after the concert, I thought, well, that was weird, but it's not going to happen again. And so the next night comes, and I'm sitting on the front row, and I'm feeling confident. Can anybody tell me what the problem is? What is it? Yeah, confidence, pride, same, can be the same thing. And so, yeah, so I'm sitting there feeling all confident, no problems. 10 minutes before the concert, all of a sudden my voice just completely disappears again. And I panicked again. There was no backup. So next thing I know, I'm on the stage again. And I started praying that God would give me my voice back. And He did, right when I needed it the most. And this happened every single night for the next 2.5 weeks, exactly 10 minutes before the concert. It was almost, I was expecting it after a while. But every night that went by, it started becoming clearer and clearer to me that God was trying to teach me something. He was trying to completely remove any self-confidence that I had in myself and to teach me that I had to rely on Him. And I can't come up front and sing about Him and talk about Him without first realizing that it's nothing I can do in my own strength. But the words and the music, it's all His. And He taught me that lesson so clearly. And the most important thing He taught me is that if I prayed and put my trust in Him, then He would always be there and bring me through it, no matter the circumstance. And I had lots of times after that. But the biggest one was when I graduated and I started a full-time music ministry. And I didn't know at the time during these Christmas concerts that this is what I would be doing. But as I look back now, I see that those are the lessons that I had to learn to do, to be able to do what I do now. And I had a full month of concerts planned in December, a few years later. And a few days before these concerts were to start, I got sick, extremely sick. I had a fever, I was in bed, and then I developed a really bad cough, and it just shredded my vocal cords, and I could not sing or talk at all. And I wanted to cancel my whole month of concerts. And everyone I told that to would just say, well, remember what God did at Fountain View. It's no different now. And I thought I was crazy. But I didn't cancel the concerts. And even though I could not speak or sing at all for that entire month outside of the concert, when I would pray and ask God to help me, my voice would come back for those concerts. And those concerts were easier than when I wasn't sick. And the second that they were over, it was gone again. And there's nothing quite like doing a concert about God's promises, because that's what my concerts were about, when you know that you're living it right then. And since these experiences taught me that I can rely on God no matter what. If I will trust him, he will not let me down. And that's continued on into music ministry. And I'll just tell you one other little thing that happened, just to show one of many things that God does to answer prayers. And that was last year. My husband and I were about to start about an 8-month tour. And one of the things we were praying for was a sound system, a portable sound system, because I was trying to schedule prisons, and I wanted to sing in prisons all over, but I couldn't do that without a portable sound system. And so we started praying, and I started fundraising and saving and shopping. Couldn't find anything, couldn't raise the money to get it, and this tour started, and I was discouraged, and I was thinking, well, what am I going to do? I scheduled prisons. We didn't get a sound system. And my husband, Ernie, he would just say, well, just trust God. He's got a plan. And sure enough, one of the first churches we went to, this person that we never met before, after the concert, he comes up to us and he says, you know, I'm an audio engineer, and I've been collecting audio equipment for years, and I've got this brand new portable sound system in my house that I'm not using. I don't know if you need it, but if you do, it's yours. And I was feeling really bad about the fact that I was doubting God so much before that. And anytime when I'm tempted to doubt God or to start stressing about things, I can look back at all these circumstances and all these experiences, how he's led, and I know that he will do the same in the future if I will continue to trust him. And that's the key, to continue to trust him no matter what. And we're told that we have nothing to fear for the future except we forget how God has led us in our past.
He carried me through, and if
How many of you know that your Redeemer is faithful and true? I'm sure we can all look back in our lives and see what God has done for us, can't we? Can't we? Okay. Had me worried there for a second. Well, I want to share one more experience of what God has done in my life and why I know that I can rely on God and that He is my truest friend. And He delights to make us happy, doesn't he? Well, every time I tell this story, I always get really excited because I can still hardly believe that it actually happened. But I'll do my best to contain myself. So for as long as I can remember, I always wanted an older brother. Always. And one day, I found out I had one. I know that doesn't just happen every day, but it happened to me, and I got so excited. He called one day, and I got to talk to him for the first time, and when I hung up the phone with him, my number one just goal suddenly became, I've got to meet him. I really want to get to know him and have the big brother that I always wanted, and so I started drawing pictures. I drew pictures by the hundreds, and I made a little sign that said, I'm raising money to buy my brother a plane ticket to come and see me. Pictures for sale, $1. And I would sit outside of gas stations and markets and I would sell them. And it worked. I bought a plane ticket. And I also bought a violin and a video camera that way. But this only works when you're really little, unfortunately. I found that out the hard way. But so I got this ticket and he came for 3 days to see us and I was so excited. But he found out that we were this crazy religious family that he didn't want anything to do with. And so when he left, we didn't hear from him again for probably 7 or 8 years. And in that time, my new goal and dream, my number one dream in life was actually to see my brother give his life to God. And I would set aside time every day to pray for him. And I prayed for him for years. And I started getting really discouraged because I wasn't seeing any results. And years go by. And sometimes we have to wait, right? God's timing is not always our timing. And so when I went to Fountain View years later, out of the blue, I think my second year in, he just calls. And he says, man, you're a hard one to track down. And it just so happened to be right before the Cali tour, and so we were going too close to where he lived. So we planned a visit, and that year I got to spend 1 day with him. And the year after that, I got 2 days. And the year after that, I got a week. And during this time, we would talk about God, but he really didn't want anything to do with it because he was just... It was all about partying at that time in his life. He had been smoking since he was 15, doing drugs, drinking, partying all the time. He just wanted to have fun. And he would tell me, he'd say, you know, God may or may not exist, but it really doesn't matter to me because all I care about, I'm just going to have as much fun as I can while I can. And when I die, that's it. It's the circle of life. It's how things work. And I'm okay with that. I've got no interest in heaven or God or any of that. And so now I'm really discouraged because I'm thinking that there's no way God's going to get through to him until a few more years go by and he calls in the middle of the night and he's crying and he says, I need you to pray with me. And everything in his life had basically just started to crumble. His health was crumbling because of all the years of smoking and drinking. He was having to take 7 or 8 energy drinks a day just to get out of bed and function. And so I had just finished up a 10-day cleanse at Bella Vita in California. I don't know if any of you heard of that. Okay, well, it's a lifestyle center. And we went through this 10-day detox, and it was intense. And so I learned and I packed up, I went to his house and I put him through that detox. And in those 10 days, just to make a long story short, he started studying his Bible. And by the end of those 10 days, he'd given his life to God. He quit smoking, quit drinking, quit everything, became a vegan. I mean, he just completely turned his life around. And it was the most amazing thing to watch. And it was watching his transformation that really made God more real to me. It's what really solidified my faith as well. But there's a song that I like to sing, and one of the phrases in it goes, "One with God, our lot we cast, will have more than we could ask." So my prayer was to see my brother give his life to God. But God had way more than that planned. And he worked everything out in his timing, even though it took years to see the results. He worked everything out perfectly. So that right at the time that my brother's going through all these changes, I was working at his pizza place one day. He owned a pizza place, which is now a vegan pizza place. And this guy walks in. And he's got spiked red hair and Marilyn Manson t-shirt and leather jacket with chains and skeleton jewelry all over. And he was part of a heavy metal band, smoking weed, just everything. And he comes walking in. And then he started coming in every single day to the store and hanging out with us. And so I told him right off the bat, I said, "Your intentions are clear." But I need to let you know that we have very big differences in our beliefs, so we are never going to be more than just friends. But I will let him tell you how that worked out.
Well, good evening. Well, we got married like 11 months ago. We're almost on our first year anniversary. But Laura found me. I was going to college. I was smoking a lot of weed with my friends, and that was one reason why I was always at the pizza shop, because I had another friend from high school that worked there. At least that was my excuse for why I was going there all the time. Really, it was to see her. But during that time, she would invite me to Bible studies, and she would invite me to concerts on Sabbath, which I had no idea what Sabbath was or what a seven-day Adventist was, even though I lived right there in San Bernardino next to Loma Linda. Go figure. Anyways, as time goes by, as I said, she found me in a place where I was smoking, I was drinking. I wasn't rock bottom. I was just kind of just going through the motions of life. And when she was inviting me to the concerts and I was hearing these preachers, you know, pour out their heart, pour out the gospel, it started to change me. It started changing me very, very slowly. And there was a couple times I think I was trying to pull away. It was too much all at once. And I was scared of it because, I mean, it's kind of a big deal, eternal life, eternal death. And she brought me to a camp meeting with Jeremiah Davis. Now, he is a very loud preacher, very, very aggressive. Okay, very aggressive is my word. But he does it in love, don't get me wrong. But that is what I needed. I needed someone just to nail the hammer in, you know, just to hit the nail on the head continually. And you talk about the sanctuary, and it's a message I've never heard before, and it got me going. That sanctuary message moved into Daniel, moved into Revelation, moved into all the other topics, and I just wanted to know more and more. So I ended up coming up here to Washington because I live in Central California or Southern California, and Laura put me through the 10-day detox, just the same thing she did to her brother. And those 10 days, I think maybe even mid, like 5 days in, I think that was when I finally just gave my life to God. And it was probably because my mind was clear. I was off drugs. I stopped eating meat. I mean, I became a vegan too. No soda, just everything. Completely cold turkey, 360, like, or 180, my bad. Turned my life around those days. And now me and Laura, we've been doing music ministry, what, two years now? Like together on the road. And we've been from here to Florida to back to here and everywhere in between. And, man, I never thought I'd be in the situation that I am. But she found me, like I said, in a place where I was just kind of going through the motions. But now I have a purpose, and now I have a reason for what I do, and I wouldn't have it any other way. So, yeah.
So God worked everything out to where I not only got to see my brother baptized, but I got to see my brother, my brother's wife, and my future husband all baptized together on the same day. That's how God can work things out. And if there's someone or something you're praying about and you're not getting the answer right away, that's okay. Because God may have bigger plans than you can even imagine. I can't believe that these things happen and my life is where it's at right now. But God gave me exactly what I needed and what I prayed for in a man with an audio engineer as an added bonus. So he does answer prayers, and he can do amazing things. And serving him with our lives, that's the best thing we can do. And so the next song I want to sing for you is actually a song that Ernie and I wrote together. It's our first, hopefully not last. And he wrote the music for it, and I wrote the words. And the words are from my own testimony about how I spent most of my life, most of my teenage years, really just not wanting anything to do with God, because I also just kind of wanted to have fun and I really wasn't paying attention. And so this talks about what Jesus did for us, the sacrifices that he made, and how so often we just ignore that because we think that our own plans are better or we just aren't paying attention. And yet we need to see that there's absolutely nothing in this world that we need, because Jesus already gave us everything that we need.
That was beautiful. It's the first time I've heard that. Yeah, I like it. Yeah, when she was talking, it brought back some memories. I remember when I used to go to her house as a little girl, she was always a little salesperson, and she'd have these little signs up, and she was always selling something. She used to call it Sales for Jesus, you know? And I remember how we used to always laugh and think, what a little entrepreneur. But it's wonderful to see how God is working in her life. I'm getting older, but so are you.
No, I'm not.
Anyway, the next song I'm going to share with you is, it comes out of a personal experience. I didn't write the song, but it fit quite well. The bottom line is, who's in control? Who do we allow to be in control? And as SDA Christians, we're going to learn, we need to learn, if we haven't learned already, that we need to let the Lord take complete control if we're going to get off of this planet. But He is constantly working to woo us and to quicken our response to His voice. I've told this story before. I want to know, I hate to say it too many times, but then again, it's a powerful story in my life. Who knows, have I told you the story of my guitar and how God speaks to me through my guitar? Has anybody? Oh, good. Praise the Lord. Okay. Well, God speaks to me through my guitar. We all have something precious and special to us. This is very special to me. More importantly, I believe it's special to God because I dedicated it to Him many years ago. And so, for years, when the ministry started moving, by the way, the Lord is so good. He's allowed me to do this now for 18 years, and I praise Him. What a privilege. But in the beginning, when we started traveling, I used to be so afraid. I had a different guitar back then, but this is the one I have now, and I always dedicate them to the Lord. But when I first started traveling, I used to be afraid. I used to be fearful because I didn't want my guitar to go in through baggage claim. Because you know what they do to those things, you know how they handle those. And things disappear. I was traveling someplace in the United States, and I saw this huge building. And I forget the name of the state that I was in, but it's a building where when the airlines lose luggage, they send it to this building, and then they sell it and make money on it. I was just amazed, and it's huge. Can you imagine how many suitcases are getting lost, or how many guitars are getting lost? Anyway, I didn't want to put it underneath, and I used to. God is so patient. God is so good. A forever friend. He worked with me so gently. In the beginning, I used to, when we started traveling, Cindy and I, my former wife, we would be getting on a plane, and I would just tell her, and sometimes my girls would be with me, and I'd say, just walk with me. Just when they start calling the first group, just walk like you know what you're doing. Stay with me, and we're getting in. Because I knew that if I got in early, I could more than likely bring the guitar on the plane with me. Well, this used to make her so uncomfortable, and it used to make my daughters uncomfortable, and they were saying, oh, we're going to be so embarrassed if they turn us away. And I just said, look, just follow me. Look, I've done this so many times. Just follow me. The Lord spoke to my heart, and He said, look, if it doesn't, first of all, you've dedicated the guitar to me. It's my guitar. It's not yours. If it makes your wife and your children uncomfortable, don't do it. And so I stopped, and I watched how God would work and get this guitar on the plane with me time and time again. 99.9% of the time, this guitar travels on the plane with me. Sometimes it travels first class when I'm in coach. And I'm going to tell you something, just to let you know, God loves to do. We need to pay attention to the little things that he does also for us, as well as the big things. But we need to acknowledge him. A few months ago, I was traveling, and I walked into the plane, and for some reason, the particular plane that we were on could not accommodate, the overhead bins were too small to accommodate my guitar. And I said, Lord, what do we do now? And I spoke to the flight attendant, and I said, look, I'll allow you to gate check this for me and then give it back to me when I get back, when I get off of the plane. Will you do that for me? And she says, no, we don't do that. And I said, and I shared with her how expensive the guitar was, and I said, I can't afford to replace it. I really don't want it to go underneath. Do you know what the Lord did? This blew me away. He moved upon that person's heart. She went and she spoke to the pilot. They put the guitar in the cockpit with the pilots. I said, if that isn't God working on my behalf to say, I love you, son. I am with you. 2 days ago, I was traveling on the plane. And again, we got on one of those smaller planes. And I don't mind, you know, if I get on the smaller plane, what can you do? You know, and they usually gate check it for me. But this woman, again, the flight attendant walks up to me and she says, you need to try and put it in the overhead bin. And I says, ma'am, I fly a lot and I know that this plane, I know the plane, and it's not gonna fit. She says, I can get it in. And I said, okay, you go ahead and try. She took the guitar, and of course she tried to get it in, and it couldn't fit in the overhead. And they didn't have a closet. Do you know what she did? She said, wait a minute, all the seats aren't booked. She went and she got this strap and she strapped my guitar into a seat. It had its own seat. And she says, Mr. Sawyer, if you'd like, you can sit with it. We serve a mighty God. And he cares for every single detail of our lives. If we will allow him, he will do it completely. He who has begun a good work in you promises that he will finish it if we let him. So, a little more history. United breaks guitars. Have you heard about that? Okay, there's a couple people. This is how God has gotten me to where I am today. A few years back, there was a fella by the name of Carroll, something Carroll, Dave Carroll, yeah, from Canada, and he sang with a country western group, and he happens to play a Taylor guitar, and he was traveling on United, and they get to Chicago O'Hare, and he and the band are sitting in, and you can check this out, I mean, it's a true story, they're sitting in the plane, and all of a sudden they hear a woman behind them go, they're throwing guitars, and they look out the window, and they see their guitars flying through the air. The baggage guys were throwing the guitars. And so he gets up and he talks to the flight attendant. He says, ma'am, those are very expensive instruments, and they're out there throwing them. What are you gonna do about it? And she was very indifferent. When he gets to his final destination, sure enough, the neck of his Taylor guitar was broken. So he addresses, he goes to United, and for an entire year, they gave him the runaround. And he says, okay, I'm gonna write a song. He wrote a song. I'm gonna sing the chorus for you. United, you broke my Taylor guitar. United, some big help you are. You broke it, you should fix it. You're liable, just admit it. I should have flown with someone else or gone by car. 'Cause United breaks guitars.
He put a simple video on YouTube and it went viral. Guess what? United wanted to talk to him now. But he said, no, it's okay, I don't need you now. Give it to some charitable cause. And, you know, he became quite famous and made quite a bit of money off of that. Anyway, I'm traveling now one day. Back in 2010, I was going through a very difficult situation. I think it was around that time, yes. And I needed to know, or maybe 2011, but I needed to know that the Lord was with me. And I'm about to board a plane, and this woman walks over to me, and she says, sir, we're going to have to tag that and put it underneath, and you can get it back at the end of your destination. I said, ma'am, I don't put this underneath. I usually take it on the plane with me. And she put her hands on her hips, and she said, if you take that on the plane with you, someone's not doing their job. Right now, I'm about getting a little warm. But I realize, I hear the voice of the Lord saying, Daryl, your first work is to represent me. Remember, it's not about you. It's not your guitar. It's not your ministry. It's mine. I said, okay, Lord. So she comes over to me with a pen to sign this statement saying that if anything happens to it, they're not responsible. Now I'm really hot. And I was about to break her pen. And again, I heard the voice of the Lord say, no, 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 don't do that. Sign the paper. It's my guitar. I said, okay, Lord. But I still had in my mind, you know what? When I get down at to go down the jetway and I walk through the door, I'll just take it on the plane with me anyway. So I'm doing that. I didn't realize she had slipped by. She was determined, very sharp lady. I'm walking down the jetway with my plan to take the guitar on the plane anyway, and there she is standing at the door with her hand out. I'll take that, please. And at that point, I surrendered. I gave it to the Lord. I got on the plane, no worries. And I'm walking off the plane now. And just as I step out of the door, I hear loud and clear, people, God still speaks to us today if we'll listen. I step out of the door and I hear, stop. And I stopped. And I look through the window there of the jetway. There's a door there where they usually bring up the strollers, etc. I look through the window and I see my guitar on top of that thing that travels with them and takes the baggage into, you know, the baggage claim and whatever. And it's on top in a very precarious position. And the woman is throwing the suitcases into this thing. And as she's throwing it, I'm watching my guitar on the top shaking. And then she finally reaches up, picks the guitar up, and she sets it upright. And she's still putting suitcases in. And as she's doing that, I'm watching the guitar shake, 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 and it's about to fall. And all of a sudden, a young man runs up and grabs the guitar. And at this point, I said, Lord, are you going to bring my guitar to me? And I just watched as he said a few words to her. He picks up the guitar, and he walks up the steps, punches in the combination, opens the door, and I took... Thank you very much. What's the lesson? Who's in control? And it doesn't matter what the authorities. Now, I'd be careful because we are told to adhere to the laws of the land as long as they don't conflict with what God says. But there's going to come a time very soon where we're going to have to make choices and we're going to have to learn to hear God's voice, and he will make it clear to us who is in control. And so, as I saw, it didn't matter what the authority the woman said, God was going to take care of that guitar, he was going to give it to me, and he was going to show me that I am with you. The name of this song is Cast Your Cares Upon Him. Thank you.
I turn my eyes toward heaven, and this is what you say. Cast your cares upon me, for I care for you. If I know every sparrow, how much more will I know you? When I'm feeling lonely and friends seem far away, I turn my eyes toward heaven, and this is what you say. Cast your cares upon me, for I care for you. If I know every sparrow, how much more will I know you? Take my yoke upon you. Cast your cares upon me, for I care for you. If I know every sparrow, how much more will I know? Shattered dreams and wounded hearts and broken toys. Give them all, give them all to Jesus, and He will turn your sorrows into joy. He never said there'd always be sunshine. Never said there'd be no rain.
He only promised a heart full of singing about the very things that once brought pain.
Give them all, give them all to Jesus. Shattered dreams and wounded hearts and broken toys. Give them all,
give them all,
give them all to Jesus, and He will turn your sorrows into joy. Give them all,
give them all.
us, shattered dreams and wounded hearts and broken toys. Give them all,
give them all,
give them all to Jesus, and He will turn your sorrows into joy. He will turn your sorrows into joy.
This next song is very special to me because it, you know, people ask me sometimes, are you afraid to go up in those big planes? I'm always fascinated how anyone could say there is no God. I flew a few times in something called a Airbus 380. Have you ever, oh, what a plane. it's hard to believe something like that could get up off of the ground and hang in the air for so long, and yet you have people that say, there's no God. Only God could create a brain that could put something like that together. I mean, you walk up the stairway in that thing is like you're walking up into a mansion, going up into first class. It's incredible. It's not like a little narrow spiral staircase like the 747. It's a huge thing, like three or four of us could walk up the thing together. And it gets up in the air, and it stays there. And people sometimes ask me, aren't you afraid that that thing is gonna come down? Know this, God is so good. If God should ever see fit to bring one of those things down while I'm in it, I'm always praying. I'm always talking to my Lord. And my confidence is that the next face that I would see is the face of my Lord. We live in a nasty world. I look at the things that are going on in politics today and just around the world, not just politics, but everything. This world is waxing old like a garment. The Lord said it would, and it's coming to fruition. If God should see fit to take any one of us, we should not fear death because we know Jesus. And in a way, if He decides to take us at this time, it's because He's protecting us. He's protecting our salvation. He wants to save. He's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come. And so, no, I don't fear flying. And I just want to encourage each person here. We don't need to fear death because Jesus is coming soon. And we'll be done with the troubles of this world. But however, when I do go, I pray. The song I'm going to sing is The Traveler. And it's very special to me. And you know, some of you that travel a lot can identify. Some of you that have maybe done, I'm going to do it with the guitar. So pray for me anyway. It's called The Traveler. Fingers get a little cool sometimes. Wow.
And trailers, long hours to daylight, a rumbling bus, our bed and our board. Heavenly Father,
Heavenly Father, remember the traveler, bring us safely home, safely home. In the town's office highway, the people are kind, they welcome us in, they sing in their church halls. Prayer songs with lifted hearts, we rejoice in the Lord. Heavenly Father, remember the traveler, bring us safely home. Heavenly Father, remember the traveler, bring us safely home. I long for my family and friends to remind me of where I have been and where I am going and where I come from.
How many of you have been blessed so far? God is very good. What wonderful music. Thank you so much for sharing. I just want to spend a moment chatting with them, just so that you can get to know them a little better. They both have ministries. They share. They go around. Laura, I want to start with you. I remember you kind of at different places in the Northwest and when you were small, and my children are like, Mom, yes, we took piano or voice lessons, I think Megan, from your mom. And I'm like, I don't remember that. But they tell me I don't remember stuff anyway. So tell me, what was there a time that we heard a little bit about Fountain View and just what was happening there. Was there a particular time that the Lord just hit your heart and said, yes, music ministry, this is what I'm going to be doing? When was, if that was a particular time, and if so, when was that?
I don't know if there was really like a defining moment. I actually, before I went to Fountain View when I was younger, I wanted to get into the music industry and go that route. And God just showed me that there's nothing there. And that my time is much better spent serving Him. And I was able to get the experience and to build different techniques at Fountain View, and that's kind of what prepared it. And then being at Fountain View and doing the tours, that helped me get my first connections, and it just kind of started. As soon as I graduated, we just kind of went into it. And
gotcha. So the Lord was doing things all along just to help prepare you for that. Really neat. What is it? What is the most exciting when you go out and you are ministering? What is the most exciting part about that for you? Where does it touch you?
The most exciting is when you hear about the effect that the music has had on other people. When they come up and they tell you their stories, you know, I had a lady tell me that she had a daughter who was dying, and she would play my CD to her every night, and it would ease her pain, and it would help her through that, and it gave her peace during her last few months. And it's hearing stories like that that just really make it, like, I know this is what I definitely want to be doing.
Wow. So you're here singing with us. Tell us, what are some of the other things that you do? Where do you go? What areas do you minister in? Where do you go?
Well, I do the concerts, also singing for evangelistic series and prisons. That's a big thing for me. I want to do prisons more, hospitals, some schools. Mm-hmm. And now that I got married, I do a lot we travel by car now. We used to be flying. And so we'll do, 7 or 8 month tours and just kind of go around the whole U.S. and it's an adventure.
Wow, an adventure. So what's your next thing? What's the next thing that you, where are you going next?
The next thing after this would be Ohio.
Ohio, yeah. Where is that? Ohio, and what will you be doing there?
I'll be singing for a camp meeting there.
Okay, camp meeting.
3 weeks.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow, thank you for sharing with us, Laura. Daryl, I tell you, we've known one another for a long time. You sing some of those songs, and I just get the warm and fuzzies because I think about being in our little country home and the kids running around and Daryl Sawyer's playing on the radio or on CD or probably tape at that time. But what is the thing? Tell us about your ministry. You have Moses Ministry, Moses Song.
Moses Song.
Tell us about that a little bit.
It came about with, when I first got out of show business, I had no idea what the Lord had in store for me. And I wanted a ministry back then. I wanted to be able to use my talent for God, but God couldn't use me then because there was still too much of the show business in Daryl Sawyer. I can look back at that now and understand that. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So nothing happened. Now, years went by, and the Lord created a new career for me working with young people, troubled youth. But I look back, and I remember also when I was a young boy, there was a song. All I can remember is these few words to this song. It was, "Those far away places, da 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 da." And all I can think about is the far away places. That's the only part of the song that stuck in my head from the time I was a very young boy. Well, I always wanted to travel to those far away places because I would look in our social studies books in school and things like that and see and read about these far away places. But because I started my life kind of backwards and wound up having a son at age 21, I thought I would never be able to see those faraway places again. But the Lord says, "Delight thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart." And it amazes me. Many years later, when I wasn't even thinking about a ministry, I was content at the point of just working to support my family. That's when the Lord opened the door for us 17 years ago, and I started traveling and singing with my family. And we started like Laura did, traveling around in a vehicle, going all over the United States. Mm-hmm. And now the Lord has taken me to 20 different countries to sing and to share not only the songs, but he's opened up opportunities for me to speak and to also do a seminar on appropriate music for the Christians. And that's Moses Song Ministries, which the Lord created, not me.
Can you tell us how did Moses Song, as far as the name, come about? Was there something behind that?
Yes. We were looking for a name, and interestingly enough, my daughter Nicole came up with the title, Moses Song Ministries. And we were like, whoa, how'd you do that? But praise the Lord. The Lord was speaking to her. And the Moses Song is the song of deliverance.
Yeah.
And we want to be able to sing the song of deliverance. We can sing that now, as a matter of fact. And then also the song of the Lamb, which is the song of victory over sin.
Amen.
And that's what Christ wants to give us. And so I hang on to the name Moses Song Ministries because I also look forward to that day when we all can sing together on the Sea of Glass.
Amen, amen. Daryl, one more question. I know that you just came in a couple days ago from Germany. That's where you are now. Daryl has spent much time at our home. Can you pick me up from the airport? You know, it's late at night, or take you to the airport or earlier in the morning. And it's just been such a blessing spending time with him. What's your next step? You're in Germany now, but what are you doing now? Share with us a little bit about that.
Being in Germany also is a miracle, because, you know, I was living up in Barnes Ferry, and I would go and I would do the ministry, but then when I turned to go home, well, home was empty, and I had no fellowship at home. And you know, loneliness can kill you. And I just found that every time I went over to Germany, first of all, they had warned me when I first was going over to Germany, the Germans are so stoic and stiff, and man, you won't make it over there. The Germans are lovely, loving people. And no, you know, if once they accept you, they are a little standoffish until they know you and they trust you, and they will give you the shirt off your back, off their backs. And I have found each year, for the last 8 years, I would go over there every year, sometimes once or twice a year. And I felt I had good fellowship over there. Well, the Lord worked a miracle. I thought of moving there all the way back in 2010, but my mother was still alive. But when Mom passed away in 2016, I said, okay, my children are grown, and I'm alone. There's nothing really holding me. I'm going to follow my dream. And I said, I prayed about it, and I said, Lord, if it is your will, open or close doors. He opened doors. And long story short, what I do now, first of all, I have wonderful fellowship over there. I have a very good church where I'm very active with the youth group there. I've got these young people that are just hungry for Jesus Christ. And what a there's nothing more rewarding than when young people come to you and they're interested, because they're the ones that are going to finish the work. And so the Lord has given me this opportunity to be over there. I'm learning another language. Whoo, what a language. Tough. But also working with these young people who are responding. And that is my joy. I can't wait for each Sabbath, because we get together after the sermon, and they will stay with me until like 4 and 5 in the evening. They don't want to go home. We're in the Word of God, and that's exciting. I also travel and sing in different countries there, because everything is so close together also. So that's another opportunity that the Lord has given me as well.
All right, one more question for both of you. Laura, when you're not ministering, you're probably ministering all the time, but what is it that you like to do? What do you
I never know what to say when someone asks me that, because we're either traveling or recording. We're traveling.
And recording. And recording and traveling.
Oh, no.
Okay. Tara, what is it that when you're not...
Ich spreche ein bisschen Deutsch. I'm learning to speak German. And when I'm not in the Word of God, I'm learning because it's keeping my brain moving. It's exercising my brain to learn this hard language. But the Lord, again, is the Lord is working.
Amen.
And it's, amen. If I'm not in the Word, I'm learning my German, or I'm trying to learn new songs.
Okay, can you say that again?
Ich spreche ein bisschen Deutsch.
Right. Okay. All right. So we want to thank you, just wonderful ministers of music. At this time, we're just going to pick up an offering for them as they go back to their homes and places to minister to those that are around them. So we, if our deacons would come forward, and we'll just have a word of prayer that the Lord would bless the offerings. Let's bow our heads. Our most kind, loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for what you've done for us thus far, and blessing our hearts as we listen to a message through song. Please bless the offerings. We thank you so much for your provisions. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Is it okay for me to talk while we're doing this? Okay. You know, one of the things that I've always wanted
And it's what I want for you too. And I've made some mistakes in my life, but I know this is something that God wants for each one of us. He wants us to have happy homes. He wants our homes to be places where angels can dwell. Our homes are supposed to be a little taste, a foretaste of heaven. And that's my dream. That's my desire. And one of the things that the Lord has shown me, because now I look back and I see some of the mistakes, it's only a failure if you don't learn from your mistakes. The bottom line is, God is preparing us to be citizens for his kingdom. And so one of the things that he has told me is, in order for our homes to be a place where angels can dwell, we have to learn to die to self. It is self that destroys homes. It is self when each person or one person has to have his or her way. That's what breaks up homes. But if we could remember that Jesus gave without expecting anything in return, that was the love of Christ. And if we can learn to give, I'm not over the hill yet. So I'm wanting to learn. I am learning. I'm learning from my past, and I'm passing this on to those of you who have homes. Make it a happy place. Put away self and pride, and remember how Jesus lived. We want to be, he is our example. You want to have your own way, it only gets you confusion and contention. But when you give as Jesus gave, our homes can be a happy place. The song I'm going to share for you is called A Prayer for Home.
Grant them peace, most precious gift of all. In front door. May the winter rains never bring them harm. May their hearth fires burn throughout the night. Grant them sleep until morning's perfect light. May it be a refuge for their love, a harbor for their deepest prayer. May they come to flourish in God's word.
To share with you a song that's become one of my favorites to sing, and it's one that many of you will probably recognize the melody. It's got an absolutely beautiful melody, but if you're anything like me, the words just don't really make sense at all. So I wanted to write some new words for this song, and I tried, and I would sit there in front of a blank piece of paper, and nothing was coming to me. And I put it away, and several years went by, and I had to go through a whole bunch of stuff first. And then one day, I was sitting there, and all of a sudden, the words just started coming, about 10 minutes, and it was done. And I know that God works that way, so that we can't take the credit for anything. And so he gave me this song as a personal testimony. Like all the songs I've written lyrics for so far, it's all from personal testimony and the things that God brings us through. And this one is just one of my favorites, and so I'd like to share it with you.
You.
You all have been very patient, and we thank you. We're going to do two more songs, and then we'll let you go home. Now, this song, I was asking the Lord recently, Lord, I was experiencing like an emptiness. I felt, and I still do, we can never get too close to God, but I just felt that there was something more, and I started praying. And you know, if you ask God to show you, He'll show you. And I asked Him, Lord, what's missing in my life? And He answered me, and He said, you don't love me enough. Ouch. But it's true. See, Jesus wants us to come to a point where we would rather die than sin. He's bringing us, He's working, and He's waiting for us to fully reflect His character, and then He will come home for and come to take us home. But He said to me, are you willing to do what I did? And He showed me, He reminded me of the days when I used to travel the subways in New York City. Have you ever, if there's anybody in here that's ever been in the subways of New York City,
yes.
And you know that it's like packed sardines. The trains are about two blocks long. If you decide to walk from one end to the other, and people that travel the trains a lot often do that because they can wind up closer to their destination, you know, getting out of the subway two blocks down the road, I mean down the street. And so I remember on this particular day I was walking. It's happened to me more than once, and it may have happened to you also. You're walking through, you're pressing your way through crowded trains, and all of a sudden you get to a car where it's completely empty. Why is it empty? You open the door, and the smell is so great that you cannot wait to get to the other side to get out of there because the smell is so bad, because there's a homeless person sleeping in the car. Someone who probably hasn't taken a bath in months, and they can actually smell up an entire car. And I remember the times when I pushed past, just didn't want to touch him, just wanted to get through. And Jesus said to me, He reminded me, He wasn't afraid to touch the leper. He wasn't afraid. It's easy to touch those that smell sweet and look good, but can we love the unlovely as Jesus did? Touch is a very important thing. Touch is a powerful healing tool. Sometimes all it takes is just a smile or a touch to make a person realize their worth, that they're important to you. And Jesus was saying to me, when you can touch those people out there in the streets, as I touch them with love in my heart, then you're on your way. The name of the song is A Touch of the Master's Hand, because He touched every one of us in here. He touched me, and He wants us to share that touch. We are His hands, we are His feet. He wants us to share that touch with others.
Now who's
just one more and we'll be through. Then he cried, one, give me $1, who'll make it two? Only $2, who'll make it three? $3 twice, you know that's a good price. Who's gonna bid for me? Raise up your hand now, don't wait any longer. The auction's about to end. Who's got four, just $1 more to bid on this old violin? Stood around as the sun was setting low. From the back of the crowd, a gray-haired man came forward and picked up the bow. He wiped the dust from the old violin. Then he tightened up the string. Now what am I bid for this old violin? Then he held it up with a bow. And then he cried, one, give me 1,000, who'll make it two? Only 2,000, who'll make it three? 3,000 twice, you know that's a good price. Who's gonna bid for me? And the people cried out, what made the change? We don't understand. Then the auctioneer stopped and he said with a smile, it was the touch of the master's hand. Well, you know, there's many a man with his life out of tune, battered and scarred with sin. And he's auctioned cheap to a thankless world, much like that old violin. But then the master comes in that foolish crowd. They never understand the worth of a soul and the change that is wrought by the touch of the master's hand. Again he cried, one, give me 1,000, who'll make it two? Only 2,000, who'll make it three? 3,000 twice, you know that's a good price. Who's gonna bid for me? And the people cried out, what made the change? We don't understand. Then the auctioneer stopped and he said with a smile, it was the touch of the master's hand. It was a touch of the master's hand. Jesus,
We are so blessed. I don't know about you, but I'm ready. I'm looking forward to going home. I'm tired. I'm tired of the pain. I'm tired of this world. But there's a reason that we're still here. We can't afford to get tired just yet. God's given us a work to do. Many of us come to church every Sabbath. But are you bringing someone to church with you? Are you remembering to reach out during the week and make sure that you're at least trying to tell somebody about the joy and the love that He has given us, the happiness and the hope that we have, the blessed hope? When I see the suffering and the pain, ooh, you know, you think you have pain over here? I've seen pain over there in Europe like I've never seen before. I don't know if it's because it's so more thickly populated or what, but I have seen people suffering, people with no legs, no feet, broken, hurting people in the street, and they all need Jesus. And that's our responsibility. We like to say we're Seventh-day Adventists, but are we really? I mean, do we really believe that Jesus is coming, and are we doing what we can to hasten His second coming? Surrendering all to Jesus. And then, you know, it won't be hard. When we really have Christ in our hearts, we won't be worried about what we look like when we go out in the streets. We won't be worried about persecution. We won't be worried about those things. That's where Jesus wants to bring us. And it's my prayer. You know, I end this, my concerts with this song, and it's now a privilege to be able to do this with Laura. But I want you to think as we share this song, that there is a land that is fairer than day. And by faith, we will see it. But nobody is going in to heaven unless they bring somebody else with them. So we need to remember that and be mindful of that. And then I look forward to being with everybody in this room on the Sea of Glass. I want to sing with you. I want to rejoice with you. I want to look back, and as Sister White says, even though there's a lot of pain, and we all, there's nobody, you know, I could tell you about my pain and my suffering, but what sense does it make? We're all going through something. If we're striving to serve the Lord, we're going through something. And if you're not going through something, something's wrong. If you're not going through something, maybe Satan has you where you want. I don't know. All I know is when I see people striving to serve the Lord, things are going on, and it's getting harder, and the devil is working more and more every day because he knows he only has a short time left. And he wants to, if he takes any one of us out, he knows that he will leave a permanent spot in God's heart, because Jesus loves each one of us in a special, in a unique way that cannot be replaced. So we owe it to him to be ready. I encourage you, and I want to see you singing with me by God's grace. We encourage each other, exhort one another, so that we can walk together in the sweet by and by. We're doing the guitar.
Are you burdened by the darkness of this lonely world? Do the trials that you face seem
Thank you both so much. Thank you for reminding us, Daryl. God made us a visual people, and can you imagine on the other side that beautiful shore when we shall be together forever? So we have so much to look forward to. Thank you all for coming. I want to thank you all for coming and spending time with us. I also want to thank our viewing audience with KHBA for coming in and spending time with us. God is so good. We're going to spend just a moment in prayer, and I wanted to remind you that out on the table in the back as you go out, both Laura and Daryl have CDs for sale, and also their album Together, Forever Friends. So remember that, stop by as you go out. Let's bow our heads. Our most kind, loving Heavenly Father, we bow before you again today. So thankful. What a blessing today has been. Lord, help us to be reminded and to remember when this is all said and done, when you return to take your people back, we will meet on that sea of glass and spend eternity with you. We thank you so much for that opportunity, that privilege of redemption, salvation. We love you, Lord, and we thank you. As we go our separate ways tonight, keep us safe. Some of us have traveled a long way, and I just ask that you keep us all safe. We thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you.